everybody, and welcome to another episode of Mental Architecture Building the Mind One Moment at a Time. I'm Howard Blumenfeld, and I'm the author of this book, which is available exclusively on Amazon. And I've got an audiobook coming out really soon, too, so you can hear more about that in the coming videos. I'm excited to come to you today to continue our talk about identity development theories, but take things in kind of a different direction. My past videos have talked about early childhood identity development, and what I want to do today is talk about a more comprehensive identity development theory. So we're going to get into the theories of Erik Erikson. Erik Erikson differed compared to his peers, you know, Piaget, Vygotsky, and Galperin, in that he believed that identity occurred throughout a child and adult's entire life, all the way from birth until right before death. So he separated identity development similarly to how Piaget did it into stages, but instead of having four stages like Piaget did, he had eight stages. So the first stage of identity development occurs in infancy, and Erikson refers to that as trust versus mistrust. And to put that simply, what that is basically a child's dependency on their parents. And so a little baby can't really do much to get their parents' attention, so they have to rely on the limited tools they have. And at that age, a child's identity is directly intertwined with their parents. They don't see themselves as a separate entity. They see themselves as almost one and the same. So the first stage of identity development occurs in infancy, and Erikson refers to that as trust versus mistrust. And to put that simply, what that is basically a child's dependency on their parents. And so a little baby can't really do much to get their parents' attention, so they have to rely on the limited tools they have. And at that age, a child's identity is directly intertwined with their parents. They don't see themselves as a separate entity. They see themselves as almost one and the same with their parents. And so the parents decide how they're going to respond to the crying baby. So if the parent gives in to the child's needs, when they cry, they feed them, or they cry in their crib and they take them out to comfort them, that's considered to be trust. And there's some psychosocial theories that would say that the baby would grow up to have a more trusting personality and a less anxious one in that scenario. But if the parents ignore the child's pleas and pretty much make the child just cry it out, some psychoanalytic theories suggest that the child may actually grow up to be more anxious and fearful. And so there's the mistrust. And so the belief is that this first stage of development, how parents and children interact with each other, will have a direct influence on how the children develop into adults later on. That's really interesting. It's something that happens at that young of an age could have such a lasting impact. The second stage of Erikson's development, it occurs in toddlers between the ages of 1 to 3 years old, and it's known as autonomy versus self-doubt. And so what happens is that as babies mature into toddlers, they start to want to get into things, they start to want to try things out for themselves. And so if parents give them autonomy or the ability to do things themselves, like maybe they want to brush their teeth themselves, the psychoanalytic theory suggests that as they grow into adults, they're going to be more confident and more willing to try new things. If parents try to stop their children from doing too many things, except of course for the most unsafe things, then that suggests that the child may grow up to be doubtful of themselves and have a lot of insecurities because of that. So again, Erikson places this really strong emphasis on how parents raise their kids at these very young ages. The third stage of Erikson's development occurs between ages of 3 and 6, and it's known as initiative versus guilt. And so it's very similar to the previous stage. These are young children exploring the world using toys, and if parents are overly critical of their children in this stage and prevent them from doing things, that can lead, just like in the last stage, to feelings of self-criticism and self-doubt as they get older, or even at that age. It can make them kind of doubt themselves. But if parents are really supportive of what their child says that they want to do, and they get toys to help foster that development and encourage them in their little dreams that they have at that young age, that can lead to increased levels of confidence that can continue to grow throughout their childhood and also into adulthood. The fourth stage of Erikson's development is a really critical one that carries children from their childhood into their teenage years, and it's known as industry versus inferiority. And so a child who's very industrious is one who from a young age has been encouraged to explore using toys and play at the park and just really build a lot of confidence, and they start to become interested in specialized things like music or arts and crafts or dancing, baseball, putting things together, building, woodworking, whatever it is, and they start to really hone those skills and develop them even more and really feel like ambassadors of knowledge in that area. They feel like they're gaining more and more knowledge and skills and abilities. But children who grew up in a less supportive environment and who continue to exist in that less supportive environment may develop an inferiority complex. These are kids who were criticized a lot, and they will just spend their time comparing themselves to others instead of going out and trying new things, and it can be a real setback for their self-esteem and their psychosocial development, as well as their skill development as well. It could set them back because of that. So again, these stages all kind of build upon one another, and there's opportunities at each stage for the children to improve in their confidence and self-esteem depending on how they're parented. Identity versus identity diffusion is the fifth stage of identity development that Erikson defines, and this occurs between the ages of 12 and 18. And in the identity part of it, this is where children again are in a supportive, wholesome environment, and they are continuing to pursue their passions, continuing to increase confidence, and might start looking at career options and choices. They tend to have a very strong sense of moral beliefs and character, and they're really grounded in their sense of friendships, and they feel like somebody who can accomplish a lot of things, and they're willing to take risks and to try out different kinds of social groups. With identity diffusion, this tends to happen when children grow up in, or at this point, teenagers are in an unstable home environment. Could be abuse, could be neglect, could just be socioeconomic factors like poverty and things, you know, beyond the parents' control. It doesn't even have to be those things. It could just be an atmosphere of negativity. A sibling is very negative. Anyways, that can cause the child or the teenager to doubt themselves and to develop a lot of anxiety, to not really be sure of what they want to do, and to sink into depression and to other episodes of self-doubt, and to be very easily influenced by others. And instead of taking their own initiative, they would tend to possibly be drawn to somebody who would try to say what they should do with their lives. And that may not be what they necessarily want to do. So it could be a lot of wasted time and wasted opportunities for a young adult like that, or, you know, teenager, young adult, interchangeable at some point, to really decide what it is that they want to do. The sixth stage of development, and this is really where things kind of take off from Piaget, Vygotsky, and Galper, and now we're heading into young adulthood, between the ages of 20 and 40, is intimacy and distanciation versus self-absorption. So intimacy and distanciation is the more positive of those two, of course, where young adults who were cared for and supported as adolescents now enter into college and eventually into the workforce very secure and confident about whatever it is they're doing. It doesn't mean to say they're not going to face challenges. Everybody does in that age bracket. That's, you know, those are your young adult years and those are tough times. But they'll find themselves in very rewarding careers, usually stable relationships, and excited and enthusiastic to raise children. Whereas the other side to that, right, the self-absorption, is where children who were raised in unstable environments tend to become very self-focused and lack confidence to really get their lives together. They may struggle in school, they may struggle in college, they may struggle to keep a job down, and they may also find difficulty in their interpersonal friendships and romantic relationships, because of, again, anxiety, stress, and other factors that can lead them to becoming more socially distant from others. Now, I want to mention that at any point, these behaviors can be addressed and corrected with, you know, psychotherapy, self-improvement, and just meeting the right people. So I don't believe Erikson meant for these to be static, but this is just what is the most likely outcome depending on how a child was raised. Generativity versus stagnation marks the seventh stage of life under Erikson's identity development theories. And this is where people feel like they want to give back to the world. They want to leave some kind of legacy and lasting mark in their careers and their personal lives. They want to produce great works and basically make the world a better place for their children and for other people's children, and just care about the world. So that's the generativity side of it. And generative adults are compassionate, they're involved in community service, they're involved with taking care of their families. Sometimes, you know, it's a stressful time because you're in that sandwich generation, especially in your 40s and 50s, where you're taking care of aging parents, taking care of children who are possibly as young as an infant, or, you know, maybe teenagers or young adults. So there's a lot of stress that goes on in this time. You're peaking in your careers. But people who are generative find ways to channel that energy into productive uses. So, like I said, mainly with the goal and the motivation to make the world a better place, to share knowledge with others, and to acquire resources for their family. On the other hand, individuals who fold under the pressure of middle adulthood may just find themselves stuck in the same old boring routine. These would be people who are stuck in dead-end jobs and they don't feel like they have the means to get out of them or to change things. Again, and this is tracing itself all the way back to their childhood, to those critical parents who were telling them they can't do something, or to those stressful times where they just felt like they couldn't do anything with their lives and they just wanted to jump out of their skin. Those things can really transfer over into later adulthood, into those years, 40 to 65. And then there's the final stage of Erikson's identity development theory, which is called integrity versus despair and disgust. So somebody who lives their life with integrity, this would be ages 65 on up, will look back on their lives and really relish their memories. They have so many good memories. They've left a legacy on their with their families and their communities, and done a lot of productive things. They have a lot to be proud of, to look back on, and they generally look back feeling like they accomplished a lot, and they feel like they can enjoy these golden years by spending time with their grandchildren and getting immersed in their children's lives and helping them out. Despair and disgust would be people who spent their 40s, 50s, and 60s kind of, like I said, stuck in a dead-end job, not pursuing hobbies, not pursuing passions, and now they just kind of live in regret, and they may live in jealousy and envy of other people who are on the other side of the spectrum, right? And they may want to live vicariously through them, and they can withdraw and turn to addictive behaviors. They can get really depressed and just feel like their life is totally worthless and meaningless. Erikson's theories are really amazing and highly tangible. I think we can all relate, I know I certainly can, to his different stages from these 8 stages of development, but they're certainly not without criticism and they're not without flaws. And so in part 2 of this series, in my next video, I'm going to talk about some criticisms of Erikson's psychosocial theories of identity development. As always, thank you for joining me for another episode of Mental Architecture, Building the Mind One Moment at a Time. Please remember to like, subscribe, and comment below if you have any questions or feedback for me. I also have an Instagram page with lots of great stuff. It's the deepest psychology you'll find anywhere on the internet, but especially on Instagram. So be sure to check that out too. And check out my book on Amazon if you want to read more. And I'm excited to tell you guys about my audiobook that'll be coming out in the summer of 2021. So super, super exciting stuff. All right, everybody, great seeing everyone, and I hope that you have a great rest of your day, and I look forward to talking to you again next time. Bye-bye.